Everybody's talking about West Virginia's showdown with Louisville on November 2nd, but Mountaineers have some work to do tonight against Connecticut. Everybody talking national title possibly for West Virginia, perhaps an undefeated season. But Connecticut moving the ball against the Mountaineers tonight and stopping West Virginia's potent rushing offense in the opening quarter. And a first down and 5 after the face mask penalty at the 22-yard line. Empty backfield, Bonislawski the quarterback. And he's going to keep. And he's very close to the marker, maybe a yard shy at the 18-yard line, dragged down by Warren Young.
You know, one of the weaknesses of a 3-3-5 defense is that most teams believe they can run the ball at you. They get bigger. Sometimes they put two tight ends in there and they just run it right at you because you got smaller guys out there.
And that's not so easy as it seems, because the smaller guys aren't standing in front of the offensive line. They're moving and shifting and coming from different angles, which an inexperienced offensive line will react to by slowing down. This inexperienced offensive line is still going fast.
11th play of the drive. Connecticut trying to keep West Virginia's offense on the sideline. On 2nd and 1, Cauley. That's the second time he's got to the outside tonight. He told us he can run. Eric Wicks missed the tackle, and it appears to be another Connecticut first down.
Cauley was not supposed to get to the corner that time, but watch him turn on the jets as he gets to the edge, and he picks up the first down. This is a guy who can run about a 4.3 40, and that's after knee surgery.
And the advantage of this against West Virginia's defense is that it forces them to stay spread out sideline to sideline. If they only ran up the middle, they could collapse inside.
You mentioned, Rob, knee injury cost him almost 2 years. He was leading the nation in rushing back in 2003 as a sophomore when he hurt that knee. First down to the 14-yard line of West Virginia. Little option, and Bonislawski throws it away. Kanyu was the intended receiver. All of Connecticut's yards on this drive have come on the ground. Cauley up the middle. Grabbed to the ankles by Boo McClure. 3 yards on the pickup.
And DP, you mentioned Connecticut running on the ground. Well, that last pass we saw sailed out of bounds. The wind is tremendously strong. From up here looking at the flags, the wind is blowing directly in the face of the quarterback. And it's hard for him to really get the ball where he needs to.
He hasn't thrown many low. Most of his misses have been up high. And when you do that to the sideline, it'll sail out of bounds. You better not miss high up the middle.
You see those flags? Well, that wind is coming pretty good.
Empty backfield, 3rd down and 8. Shotgun for Bonislawski. Late blitz coming. Pass into the end zone. And it's incomplete. Nearly intercepted by Eric Wicks. Quinn Andrews was also there for West Virginia. Bonislawski almost cost his team 3 points.
Well, he's a senior, but he's a guy that hasn't played quarterback a lot. He only played 1 year as a starter in high school, has been hurt most of his time here, as you see him take a shot to the head there.
Now, Connecticut has had all kinds of trouble on field goal attempts. And they're going with a new kicker tonight, Tony Chirivino, his first career field goal attempt. Connecticut is 3 of 9 as a team this year. 29-yard try for Chirivino. And he nails it. Connecticut not only is on the board, we've got a tie game early in the second. He's going to kick it away from Raynaud. Little pooch kick. And it's going to be fair caught at the 35-yard line. Contact after the fair catch, and that's a penalty on Connecticut. Can't do that. Abraham Jones with the fair catch at the 34-yard line for West Virginia. On a fair catch, you cannot contact the return man.
After the play was over, personal foul on the kicking team. 15-yard penalty from the end of the play. First down.
And that's what you don't need if you're Connecticut after you've stolen momentum away from West Virginia.
And that's because their defense has been pretty good. And they've brought pressure. They've loaded up the box. 7 guys, 8 guys, taking away the perimeter.
They're inside, they're filling the gap, so there's no place to run. Take a look at the blue jerseys, all surrounding the ball carrier. There's nowhere to go.
West Virginia with its 3rd offensive series of the game. 0 for 2 in terms of touchdowns for them. That's rare. White pitches to Slayton, and he's got the corner. Two more missed tackles. Slayton eventually down at the 41-yard line. Gain of about 8 on the pickup. Let's go to Heather for more on this Connecticut defense.
Well, we talked to defensive coordinator Hank Hughes, who said, you know what, we can't trick teams. We've got to execute. We're not going to slow them down. It's not going to be magic. It will be execution. We can't outplay you physically, so we want to out-scheme them. Always have them trapped to leverage, trap them inside and outside so they're never one-on-one. They also think that the corners need to be involved in the run game. Do you guys think that they're doing that so far?
Well, yeah, they have been, Heather, except on that last play. Their corner on the left side got caught up inside, and Slayton was able to get outside and beat a guy one-on-one.
Well, Rod, when you've stacked the box, it means the corners have to cover one-on-one. If they're also asked to be involved in the run game, what kind of stress does that put on?
Well, you're in a double bind. I mean, you really have a hard time playing off of the run when you've got to read, playing off the pass when you have to read the run first as much as they are now tonight.
They measure, and he comes up a little bit short, so it'll be second down and inches.
You know, we were talking about defensive principles before the game, guys, and you always want to try to get two guys into an area to make a tackle. You don't want to design your defense to have one-on-one tackling, because good backs will always beat one-on-one tackling.
Connecticut has struggled this year stopping the run, but has been very good defending the pass, but the opposite has been true tonight. West Virginia's only been able to move the ball through the air. They're going to go out of the eye here and put White under center on second down and inches. We've seen this a lot tonight. Owen Schmidt, a powerful fullback, is the up man, and he gets the carry to the 39-yard line for about 3 yards. Here this year, can they shut down the number one scoring offense in college football? Connecticut done a pretty good job against the number three scoring offense in college football. As West Virginia has just 3 points, Slayton on the carry gets to the 34 for 3 yards, tackled by Ryan Hennigan. Well, you talked about it earlier, Slayton and White both playing with a chip on their shoulder in the sense that they want to prove to other teams that they were wrong in not recruiting them.
Look at Pat White at the top of the screen. There was a defender right there, Dante Moore, looking at him to make sure he handed that ball off. And he might have a chip on his shoulder, but he's got a linebacker in his grill right now.
Rich Rodriguez told us these are both great kids. They're all about team. You tell them, hey, we want you here at this time to do this, and they are there, and they're great leaders. White going to the air, throws another strike, caught inside the 20-yard line by Rashawn Bolden. White looks terrific throwing the football tonight.
Well, Rod, you talked about how Connecticut is stacking the box, putting a linebacker on White, whether he's got the ball or not, and forcing him, daring him to throw.
Well, watch that relationship out there. You've got man coverage, and that's tough out there when you have a lot of room. You can't pin the guy into the sideline, and White is moving that way and finds the lane to him.
White is 6 out of 7, 83 yards passing. Back to the shotgun. Ball on the Connecticut 17. Slayton. No running room. Taken down at the 22-yard line for a 5-yard loss by Dan Davis.
And Dan Davis played that play as well as you can play it. And he just does not give up that outside leverage. He forces everything inside on that play.
Now take a look at the defense shift, and now they're coming off this side, and that allows them to get extra guys to the point of attack.
So second down and 15 at the 22. White on play action, going to the end zone for Slayton. Incomplete. Good coverage by safety Dana Deliston on Steve Slayton. It'll be third and 15.
Well, the one thing that's really impressive about this defense is everyone is playing as a team. They are doing their own responsibilities. No one's trying to help somebody else out. That's how mistakes happen. They're playing their role.
Well, they didn't do that against Navy, and Navy lit them up with their option. But this is the kind of discipline that Randy Edsall wants, and this is kind of one of the reasons why he dismissed those 5 players for a lack of discipline.
West Virginia 6-0 for the first time in 10 years, trying to keep its Big East and national title hopes alive. White going to the air again. There's contact downfield, but no flag down. The pass incomplete.
And this is the challenge that Patrick White will face. When teams are able to load the box, they are daring him to complete the intermediate pass. This one here. This is a pass that has to be completed. Now, there was some grabbing down there and holding, and he wants to get a penalty on Butler, but it wasn't called.
Yeah, it looked like Butler did impede the progress of the receiver with his left hand.
Grabbed him a little bit.
Brandon Miles was the intended receiver. Here's McAfee from 39 yards, already made a 38-yard try. And he is good once again. So three more points for West Virginia. But Rich Rodriguez wants a lot more than that. For a field goal. And Connecticut will let this kick sail out for a couple of years. Connecticut takes over on its 20-yard line. Pauley gets hit in the backfield once and not getting away a second time. Mark Magro will get credited with a tackle on Cauley. Big loss on first down for Connecticut.
Now, Connecticut still going into the wind. I'm sure that makes them a little bit reluctant to throw the ball, particularly backed up, you know, in the shadows of their own goalpost.
Connecticut 3-3 on the year. The wins for the Huskies against Indiana, Army, and Rhode Island. Not exactly juggernauts. But they are hanging in there tonight against West Virginia. Mountaineers showing blitz on a 2nd-and-14 play. Bonislawski got the pass away, but it's dropped by Anderson to the 20-yard line. That would have been positive yardage, but Anderson dropped it. Jay Henry came and got in the face of Bonislawski.
Well, you can see that they're conceding the deep pass to the wind. They're trying to just nickel and dime it down here because it's the wind is so strong. On this 3rd-and-13 or 14 that they have here, it's going to be hard for them to get the ball down the field.
It will, and we saw Bonislawski miss again high. If he keeps doing that, it's going to turn into a big turnover at some point.
Blank for Bonislawski in the passing category. 0-for-7 so far. And the throwing situation here on 3rd-and-14. And again, West Virginia coming with pressure, a little shovel pass, and into the secondary is Cauley, and he gets wrapped up about 5 yards shy of the first down at the 25-yard line. So that first down loss of about 4 yards really hurt Connecticut on that drive. 2nd-and-3 and out by West Virginia's defense. Connecticut will punt.
This figures into West Virginia's offensive game plan. They want 3-and-out and get that offense on the field. West Virginia's offense goes no huddle in 3 tempos, fast, faster, and ludicrous fast. And they want to keep them out there so they can wear down the defense.
Because you have to think it's only a matter of time for West Virginia's offense. Pavasaris's kick gets hung up in the wind. Fair caught by Vaughn Rivers at the 41-yard line. And there is a penalty flag down. It's going to be against Connecticut. We'll see if West Virginia wants them to kick it again into the wind. It was a 34-yard punt by Pavasaris.
I don't know how good of an idea it would be to have him kick it again because...
Holding number 22 on the offense. 10-yard penalty from the line of scrimmage. Repeat 4th down.
That was a short putt anyway, but in the wind, the ball won't carry, but it also moves around and makes it more likely for the punt returner to muff it.
Don't forget, too, West Virginia has a propensity to block kicks. And if you've given up chances, they've gotten close now twice. And it's a little bit more dangerous when you're down here right along your goal line.
Yeah, and that penalty backed them up 10 yards. And so this is a tougher kick for them now and greater field position expectedly for West Virginia.
They're missing a guy.
Yeah, they're short a guy.
Only 10 players on the field. That was Deion Anderson who rushed out there at the last moment. Here come the Mountaineers, and they almost got it. And a bad kick. But it takes a couple of Connecticut hops. Still, West Virginia gets about 14 yards out of it. And we'll start inside Connecticut territory. Patrick White. At West Virginia offense bounce back against UConn's defense, which has held them to 2 field goals so far in the game. Slayton, or make that White on the fake, and White is gone inside the 20. Touchdown, West Virginia, on its first play of this drive. And a great ball fake by Patrick White.
It happens so quickly. And prior to that play, the longest play on the ground was a 9-yard run. And this time, they get it going. A fake here and a good block on the outside by number 2, Darius Renaud, and Patrick Wright cuts it back up inside.
45-yard touchdown run. White had touchdown runs of 32, 40, 69, and 12 yards against Syracuse last week. Extra point good. Ninth rushing score for White this year. And that looked like Rich Rodriguez's Mountaineer offense.
Well, that time they didn't fill the lanes. Patrick White is going to come toward the bottom of the screen down over here. Now, take a look at where all the blue jerseys are. There should be one right in there, but there isn't. And he notices that and squirts up through. That's the discipline assignment football that they need to play. And that was their first mistake so far this game, and White made them pay.
And you also saw the defensive end, Chase Slayton. And Patrick White just ran right by his hip. He was still looking at the running back, Steve Slayton, thinking he had the ball.
Well, the thing is, when you get in space, you got a big area to cover, you're in a mismatch with Patrick White. You can't cover him, you can't tackle him when he can go left or right, and now you're a big defensive end or a linebacker and trying to contain him.
Such an incredible athlete, Patrick White, guys. He was drafted by the Anaheim Angels in 2004 in the fourth round as a center fielder, and he got offered between $300,000 and $400,000, turned it down to play college football. And the Angels said after that, man, we would have offered him more money if we would have known he was that serious about football. They wanted him to play baseball for them that badly.
Well, and a number of SEC teams, Tennessee, Auburn, Alabama, they wanted him as a wide receiver or defensive back.
Originally committed to LSU and then decommitted to play at West Virginia as that kick sails out of bounds, and Connecticut starts at the 20.
Outside the pocket.
Play fake by Bonislawski. Just gets hammered. But he completes his first pass of the game out to the 25-yard line. Caught by Dan Murray. Taken out by John Holmes.
Well, White's just a sophomore. A lot of people project him as a receiver in the NFL, but I think he's got a good shot to play quarterback in the NFL, especially now with Vince Young joining Mike Vick in the NFL and plays being called that they ran so successfully in college. Some of the spread option that we're
calm,
so good
calm
about.
Calm down, calm down. Let's let him be a college quarterback for a while. He doesn't have to get to the NFL yet. Let him play.
No, I want to see what he's going to do in the NFL.
He is just a sophomore. On second and two, Cauley looking for a hole. It's not there. Wrapped up and thrown to the floor, and the ball's out at the 27-yard line. Mark Magro on the tackle. West Virginia's ball. Holmes came out of there with it. Let's see, though, if they rule the Connecticut. Dennis Hennigan, the referee.
After review, there's indisputable video evidence that the runner was down before the ball came loose. There is no fumble on the play. It will be Connecticut's ball. Down.
That's enormous for the Huskies right now after that last West Virginia drive, if you call it that. It was a one-play, 45-yard drive.
Well, absolutely enormous. West Virginia makes its money putting up huge amounts of points in short periods of time. Georgia, in the first 16 minutes of the Sugar Bowl, was down 28 to nothing before they broke a sweat. So this allows Connecticut to avoid that, at least at this point.
At some point, do you think Connecticut's going to have to get it going through the air to beat West Virginia tonight, guys?
Absolutely. We talked about that at the beginning of the show, that they have to find a way for the young receivers to catch the ball and for that young offensive line to give Bonislawski some time.
They have a pair of two freshman wideouts in Terrence Jeffers, Brad Kanyu, five freshmen in all in the starting lineup for Connecticut. So third down and two at the UConn 28. Play fake. Bonislawski hit as he releases it, and a diving grab by Murray for a first down. Boy, is Connecticut glad to have Murray back. He's played sparingly this year due to an ankle injury. Their best receiver.
Well, Bonislawski stands in. He knows this linebacker's coming at him. Keep in mind, Bonislawski broke his collarbone last year and aggravated that injury later. And for him to stand in with a linebacker right in his face, take a shot on that collarbone, great courage.
That keeps West Virginia's offense on the sideline. There's down to the Connecticut 34, another play fake. And the pass on the money to Kanyu pulls it in for another UConn first down.
And that was his best throw of the night. And that ball was thrown low and outside where only Connu could get it.
Seventh catch of the year for true freshman Brad Connu is from Johnstown, Pennsylvania, which is not very far from Morgantown, West Virginia.
Well, that should help his confidence. And you know, the more balls he catches, the better he'll be. He's a sprint champ. He's a fast guy. They need to find a way to get him in position, you know, to make some big plays.
After an 0-for-7 start, Bonislawski's completed his last four. They go back to the ground game. Terry Cauley on the call. And Warren Young brings him down after a gain of about three at the 49.
You know, Trevor, one of the best things about what Connecticut is doing is it's keeping Patrick White on the bench.
They don't allow that tempo to wear down the Connecticut defense. So much an important part of the way that the West Virginia defense interfaces with the offense. When the offense does well, the defense gets a three and out, and then all of a sudden they're on roller skates.
And if Connecticut can keep the drive going, take time off the clock, and get more points, it would start the third quarter with the football. They won the toss and elected to defer to the second half. Bonislawski sacked. Back at the 40-yard line by Eric Wicks. Loss of 9 on the play.
And you always have to know where that fourth and fifth rusher will come from. Wicks is the guy who comes off the bottom. He's athletic enough to beat the tackle. He doesn't even get touched by Ryan. He simply uses a move to get by him. That's why you have that fifth defensive back. You use that athleticism to make your plays.
West Virginia didn't have a single sack in the first month of the season, but they chased a lot of quarterbacks around. You can see that the first four games, none. But they were close a lot, and they had a lot of hurries. In the last two games, they've been able to close and get there.
Third sack of the year for Wicks. Third down and 15. Bonislawski looking to set up the screen. Cauley breaks one tackle and another. And out of bounds at the 49-yard line. He's going to be about 5 yards shy of a first down. If you're Connecticut, do you take a risk and go for it here, or do you just boot it away? It appears they're going to punt.
Yeah, I think that's a smart thing to do. You need to boot it away here. You really don't want to take a chance and give full momentum to West Virginia, you know, at midfield. Now you have a chance to kick the ball inside the 15-yard line and back them up and maybe get the ball back.
This is a time for one of those rugby punts, though. Don't get it up into that wind.
Pavasaris to boot it away. West Virginia's been close to blocking it. Not that time. Rivers past the 25 and stood up at about the 27-yard line. Lou Allen led the charge for Connecticut on special teams. And potent West Virginia offense back on the field when we come back.
Back maybe? Don't know.
Leaving a lot of money on the table, about $8 million if he decides to quit. And perhaps a shot at the Hall of Fame if he decides to quit. Here's a pitch out to Slayton. Connecticut slams him at the 25-yard line. Tyvon Branch and Dan Davis track him down.
Well, Branch is the corner. Remember, Heather talked about it earlier about the corners getting involved in the run game. That's exactly what happened this time. You had Branch coming off the corner hard once he read the run and turned the play in.
Loss of one on the play. A lot of negative rushing plays for West Virginia so far in the game. Second and 11. And White to the air. He's had a lot of success throwing the ball. Finds Slayton out of the backfield past the 30. They're fine with the fact that they were dismissed from the team. Pat White picks up the first down on third down and short. Dante did not factor into his decision. And again, we will debate that in the second half, whether his decision was too harsh, whether that punishment fit the crime. As White takes off to the 45, got five of the play. Lansana out on that play. Dan Davis on the tackle. Lansana wants to get back in there.
Randy Edsall is still in the beginning stages of building this program. Keep in mind that Connecticut started their first full 1A season in 2002, and so Edsall still is saying, I want to build this team on discipline and reliability. One of the reasons he got rid of those five.
Hand off to Slayton, and another loss, another negative rushing play. Dana Deliston makes the play in the backfield, and a key third down coming up.
Once again, you're getting penetration, Trevor, from the secondary. Look at that great play. by Deliston coming in, taking on a block, and turning the play in and making the tackle. The secondary players have been very effective against the run game.
Seven running plays for zero or negative yards by West Virginia's offense. When's the last time that's happened? Third down and six, and White picks up the first down with another nice toss. Caught by Reynaud to the 45-yard line of Connecticut. Let's go back to the studio. Reese Davis. Reporting. All right, Reese, how about the underappreciated passing ability of White? He goes back to the ground and gets inside the 20 into the 15. We know about his running skills, but his passing accuracy has been the subject of discussion tonight.
Well, you know, the spread offense allows him to get in space, and when he's in space, he can make plays. Take a look at what happens out here. He's going to get out there to the edge, and you're going to ask a guy in one-on-one situation to make a tackle right there. Patrick White just runs around him because he's got the room to do it.
Great block by Darius Reynaud downfield to spring White for 30 yards. 88 rushing yards tonight. He's just 4 yards away from tying Donovan McNabb for second all time in Big East for quarterbacks. And he may have gotten it on that play to the 10-yard line. Tackled by Robert Vaughn.
Timeout, West Virginia. That is your first timeout of the half.
You know, guys, it's amazing. This is only the 12th start for Patrick White, and he's already matched Donovan McNabb for rushing yards for a quarterback in the Big East. That's impressive.
42 seconds.
Two timeouts remaining for the Mountaineers. They lead by 10, looking to score again. White to throw on second down and five. Instead, he tucks. Beautiful move at the five to pick up the first down and get to the four. Dan Davis on the tackle. West Virginia still has a pair of timeouts left. The clock will stop for the moment to get rid of the chains and reset the ball.
And he wanted to throw it, but had to tuck it down, and does pick up the first down.
West Virginia.
And, you know, guys,
their second timeout of the half.
West Virginia needs this score. They have to put up points. You know, Heather mentioned at the top of the show, style points. There are a lot of people who have.
White keeps on first down and goal, trying to power into the end zone, and he is stood up at the one. Rayma Fuller, along with Vaughn on the tackle for UConn.
Timeout, West Virginia. That is their last timeout of the half.
Well, Fuller goes flying.
For West Virginia, they are going to go for it. They are out of timeouts. White hands for Schmidt. Easy touchdown for West Virginia. Huge hole off the left side, and the Mountaineers score again.
Well, when you're trying to pick up less than a yard, you have a 250-pound fullback, might be a good idea to give him the ball and let him get in there. I mean, you see a double team block at the point of attack, and he goes right behind it.
And nothing fancy here. No pulling, no trapping. The offensive line going straight forward, and the big fullback bulldozing behind him.
Brad Palmer, a tight end, the up man, started at fullback against Connecticut last year with the block. And it gives Rich Rodriguez another touchdown. It's 20-3 Mountaineers. You know, guys, Rich Rodriguez has really done an excellent job with this West Virginia football team. And, you know, he coached that spread offense at Clemson with Woody Dantzler, Tulane with Sean King. And Rasheed Marshall did a great job running that spread offense at West Virginia. And we've seen Patrick White do it tonight already, 100 yards plus, both rushing and passing.
You know, that spread offense was pretty good with the guys like Sean King, where he was the offensive coordinator at Tulane, and pretty good with Woody Dantzler. But he didn't have anybody quite as fast as Patrick White. I mean, Dantzler was outstanding, but nobody with the flat-out speed that Patrick White has. And all this began back at Glenville State, and the spread was a passing offense, and he didn't really get into the running game of it until later on.
Bro, that's what I like about it. He isn't wedded to the system. The spread at Tulane with Sean King was mostly a passing spread. And when he got here to West Virginia, the players that he had lent themselves to the spread with this style of running, and now he's recruited to it specifically, and those players are even better.
And Rodriguez upset a lot of people when he took the job at West Virginia, got rid of most of the coaches on Don Nealon's staff. And the biggest reason was because he didn't want to have to teach coaches that were on that staff how to run the spread offense. He wanted guys that knew how to do it. He went 3-8 his first year. There were a lot of growing pains, but people love Rich Rodriguez now. They liked him as a player, former walk-on, but he disrupted what a lot of people felt was continuity there because Don Nealon had been there for so long.
But everybody thought things would continue the same way, but he not only changed the offense, he changed the defense. He was changing the culture, and there was friction early on. Don Nealon said, you know, the cupboard wasn't bare. We probably shouldn't be 3-8.
And you talk about changing the culture, Rod, that we're seeing that now, and the culture of West Virginia now, has you can't argue with it.
Patrick White, dynamic in that first half. He had the big touchdown run of 45 yards on that drive that started in Connecticut territory. Let's go down to Heather Cox.
Coach, Connecticut's defense seemed to stop you early. What adjustments did you make to get your offense going late?
Well, they're doing a great job of keying on Stevie and doing a really good job tackling. We got to do the quarterback runs a little bit, and we got to get Big Owen Schmidt running a little bit. And our guys are feeling okay, and they're a good football team. We're playing against them, playing very hard.
All right, best of luck, Coach. Already 7 negative runs, guys, by West Virginia.
Yeah, Connecticut did a decent job, but not good enough, as West Virginia leads by 17 at the half. The Mountaineers scoring on 4 of their 5 possessions. Back to the studio now and restate.